Ah.
So.
Okay.
I have a little surprise for both of you.
Thank you.
You can open it on behalf of you and Shannon.
I'll say
for both of us?
Yeah, it's for both of you. It's for sharing.
I don't like this. I don't like when I don't know what the cold open is. I've been burned before.
What is
you
this?
You can take it out.
Wait. Drop your bath. There's been a merge. Are you? Are you pregnant?
I'm pregnant.
Oh my gosh, shut up! That is such good news, babe. I'm so happy for you.
We got a little stats auntie.
That is such good news.
Yay. Oh, we got a little survivor baby.
That's amazing.
This is so cute.
That's amazing.
It's actually so cute.
It's been a merge.
That is so cute, Brooke.
Oh, my God.
Welcome back to Australian Survivor Talking Tribal. I'm Survivor expert Shannon Guss, here with Brooke Jowett and Khanh Ong, Survivor players who are definitely my mentors, not my pawn. The King survived another week, but he had to work for it. Check this out.
Well, I was very intrigued that George flipped on you, Jared, and then tried to cover his tracks. But I think my gut thinks it was like all kind of part of the plan in the first place.
And he's just shot himself.
I'm on the bottom. Yeah. Mimi's in the bottom. And you've been left out of that. You're on the bottom. I mean, this is an amazing opportunity to someone just there.
Little crab.
Yeah, that's a George move from the outback mm-hmm. where he would hide in the grass like a snake. What do we think? Is that a good way to handle isolation?
I don't understand how people don't hear that because I feel like he couldn't sneak around each other at all.
Do you think George was close enough to hear anything then?
Probably. Why not?
Because I don't think he was actually that close.
Oh my gosh. No, I mean, what did we think of the isolation pen in general? We've never seen a twist like this ever, so is it something that you enjoy?
I love it. Like little piggies in a pen.
I hate it.
I feel like,
but imagine if you were in there. You'd just be sitting there and be like, is someone going to feed me?
I know, but it's a little bit better than exile. Like, you can actually get fed properly. Like, exile, you'd have to work from scratch.
Oh, but I feel like, as though if we're in that pen, like...
Pen, like they're literally farm animals.
I'm still shocked about your announcement, so I can't string words together. But like, sorry. I feel as though like if you can watch people strategizing and like having fun or doing whatever together, I think that hurts so much more than being heaps far away, not knowing anything, just being like, yep, this is my life now.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, I think that they want them to see it because it like really demarcated, like you were left out of the vote, which was, I think, unfortunate for George. I mean, obviously we see George going like all out social, taking the chair in the middle of the night. But like, there's no way they like they choose if they feed you. Firstly, any human beings are gonna feed them, right?
Yes.
And, like, bring them water.
Okay, I mean,
I'm
unless
really
it's
glad
like
you said that because I felt like you weren't going to.
She would feed us.
One reason. They're players you want to work with. And they're jurors one day. Like,
that's true.
It. They're either one of those two things. So why? What person? And anyway, come on.
What if it was someone that, like, completely stabbed you in the back and did the worst thing?
Sure, of course.
Would you let them stab?
No!
I think I might be a wood.
What?
Really?
I know. It's so unlike me.
It goes against my
But
nature.
If it was someone that was really, really nasty to me, maybe just give him a few grains of rice.
You work for your rice.
You work for this.
Yeah. So obviously this was not great for George and Jerry. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of confused. I'm like, is Jerry really trying to flip? Because he talks to us about it in confessional. So usually people are pretty truthful in their confessionals. I was like, is Matt bringing him back? Is that bond with George that we see at Tribal Council putting him on the right path? Like, did you think Jerry was out the door here?
I did.
Yeah, same. I felt like I would have been really annoyed as Jerry because, like, I wouldn't believe what anyone was telling me. I would just believe that, well, there was a vote put on me and it definitely came from George or, like, from, like, the idea came from George. Like, so I would have been so annoyed by this.
Yeah, it is hard because Jerry should know, like, he was never really in trouble. He was the third split. He knew that he was splitting on Nina. Like, he should have known that there was no chance he was going to go. But I think what it does illustrate is that George is the one, as we've known, planting the seeds, moving the pieces around, doing everything at his will, which at this point was to turn everyone against each other. Mm. So that would be a little bit unfortunate. But I feel like Matt was probably quite crucial here. Like, after being the one last week who really wanted to turn, it felt like he and George were on the same page yeah. more this time. So I don't know if it was Matt that brought him back, but I think we do see that George and Jerry, when they get back on the same page, have like such an important, like genuine relationship that I think could be very, very key to George.
I just feel like there was such a big change from like the way Jerry was speaking when he was in the pen to how he was at tribal council. Mm. Like, I don't know what we missed or if we missed anything at all, or if he, maybe he was just playing Nina, but it did really seem like Jerry was going yeah. to potentially flip on George.
Yeah.
Whereas at tribal, he just starts vomiting all this praise to George. And I'm like, what's happening?
I think what it is he's more annoyed at Simon. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
it's
like
bigger enemies.
Yeah, like he's more pissed off about what Simon says about him than what George did to him, which I think is kind of weird, but I feel like that's how he feels.
George has previously called himself the puppet master, and he has set up three people around him, three pawns, to protect him, and I've been quite impressed by that.
Yeah, I mean, Jerry's very, very frank, which is very enjoyable to me. Like, I really understand him as a character, and I think that it's really fun. I do think that there's part of that with Simon, and it's so ironic that it would... I don't know if it was going to happen anyway, but definitely the way it was painted to us, that, like, Simon would stick his foot in it to send himself home or to contribute to that is definitely, like, a fun thing for his narrative. But I do agree. I think that it's like, you're against George, but then now you're on the same team against Simon. So now we're on the same page, and I think that that is crucial and crucial to the entire week. Later, I think... when George is going to vote out Nina over Matt, he's like, I want Jerry to be happy. He needs to show Jerry that he's also calling the shots. So that's a very important relationship, because if you're trying to get through to a final two and you're not really going to win a challenge and you have a huge target on your back, the thing that has helped people the most is loyalty, relationships, friendships, and Jerry could be that if he could maybe win a challenge. But I think that that is crucial to him.
I actually think it's a really hard road for George moving forward from here, because I don't actually see him, unless he won a challenge, I don't see him going through.
Yeah, I mean, that's just,
I don't think it's possible.
Really, really hard. Like, we're definitely going to talk about the road because it's a tricky one. For Nina, do we think that there was more she could have done? Because I feel like this was it.
No, she was literally like, she was just hounding Jerry that whole time.
I love seeing that side of Nina, though, like when she just really has to dig deep and just throw everything at it. And that's exactly what she did in that pen. I still love that it's a pen. But she really did try everything.
Do you find it interesting that when they came over, he made sure Matt told you what happened, not him? And made sure Matt explained everything, not him?
Yeah.
I think that's more interesting because he knows that you're upset with him, not Matt.
I think for Nina, I love that it's our running theme of her post-merge game to be like, well, I'm just going to lay it all out there. I'm just going to bury Haley. I'm just going to bury George. Give me all the information I've had. And now it's all out there. Mm-hmm. At times, I think that it was maybe a little much and made her to be a little bit of a liability. Like later on when she's saying to Matt, it's 2v2 and George is in the middle. Like if he's looking to work with you, coming across like, it's a little unworkable. But in times like this, when she's been voted out or when she's like really on the bottom and she's outed it, it was a fun thing because I feel like it was almost Sandra-esque, like that Sandra would come back in the middle of the night and just air dirty laundry. Like that feels like something that she would do. That's twine to me.
The thing that I love about this isolation pen is that you can't have a conversation without the other person hearing.
Yeah.
And when
yeah.
they're discussing what the plans are, it's so awkward because Nina's just sitting there being like, I know you, I'm part of this plan.
Yeah, they should have done that every single time. Like, so they hold these conversations and just scan over to her and she's just sitting there. Yeah, like, then that's like, why. And Liz said, that's why it's so hard.
Yeah, I love it.
I wonder if she just sat there and went, I can hear you. Yeah. I can hear you.
I'm literally right here.
Same plan as last night. And she's like, well, I'm sitting here. Yeah. So I know love the plan. That. I know that there could be votes on me. So.
But again, like, why is no one taking the swing? Oh, I'm just like, what?
I'm done. Just let him win.
More, yeah.
Like, at this point, I'm just like, I give up. Like, I'm done here.
I think you're contracted for the rest of the season. Yeah. To be on Dog Tribal, so it's not actually your choice.
Yeah, you're stuck
oh,
now.
Oh, God.
Okay, we need to take a break. When we're back, don't mess with Jerry.
Welcome back to Australian Survivor Talking Tribal. Both Simon and Nina were eliminated this week, and if we learn anything, it's don't call Jerry a pawn.
George's expertise in this game is second to none.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to jump on board and I want to learn some of that stuff. Give it to me. This is gold.
Give it to me.
And not only do we have a relationship, a friendship, but he's also a great mentor, even with the age difference. You're never too old to learn. I've been working with George and learning from him to play this game. And he's been a bloody good teacher because I'm still sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Jerry.
Six from the top. And that's honest.
That's one of the nicest things someone's ever said about me.
Oh, Georgie.
No, but it's true.
Yeah, but where does it get you?
Yeah, when does he?
I get it. It's true. Yes, amazing. You're a mentor. But where does it get you? What, to six or maybe to five, to four? Where does it take you to the end? It probably won't. Like, I get his argument. He's like, I'm not a pawn. I'm here because George is my mentor. But you can't go against your mentor at the end. Like, it's not going to happen.
Well, yeah, your mentor will win.
That's what your mentor would teach you to do. Like, WWGD, what would George do? He'd take out George, probably.
Exactly.
And there was a famous story. Rob Sestanino, again, my boss. He coached this person up the entire game, had him there as a pawn, but taught him the ways of the game. And then at the very, very end, at the final three, when he won the challenge, this Matt, who he'd taken through, also a Matt, actually, Mateo, and he took out Rob, because he had learnt the game at that point. Yeah. So it's like Frankenstein's monster had become like a little bit sentient at that point to do that. So I think it was interesting that Jerry said to Simon about it being like a coach.
Yeah.
But the issue is you aren't competing against your coach. Like, it's a different dynamic. My issue is all that matters is what the jury thinks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think some of this will not be well received by a jury if Jerry gets there, because I think that they won't agree. I think they won't agree that they were all captains of the ship at different times.
Yeah.
And I think that's what matters. We see that Jerry obviously is so important to George later when he doesn't take out Matt to keep Jerry happy. And I think that whatever he's planning for the end game, and I don't really know what it is, because I think his pathway is extremely difficult, as we'll talk about, but I think Jerry must be crucial to it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't get it. I
would want to take Jerry towards the end or to the end if I was one of them.
I would. If I was George, though, I would probably take Matt.
Would you?
Yeah, because I actually think that Jerry's done more.
Do you?
Yeah.
I'd love to talk about that. Jerry versus Matt as like a jury if they sit together, because I think that's a distinct possibility.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to just say Matt because he's cute and young and, like, you know, saves lives. I mean, because that's...
Jerry saves lives too, and he's cute as well.
That is true. But I feel like Jerry hits my heartstrings because he's got that fatherly figure, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm.
So I mean, there's a bit of both.
Yeah, I sit with it in Jerry, I feel, will have an argument that people won't respect as much. I think Matt crying in confessional, knowing his place more and knowing that some people will see it as more passive at points, that'll feel real to the jury in a way that I think will be a little better.
But what you just said, the jury don't see. What, like, what,
yeah, but
what,
if he were to come in with that energy, not that he'd be crying there, but if he comes in and is like, look, I know what points I was led, here are the specific things that I did, and doesn't overstate his game. Mm. Where if Jerry is going to come in and say, I was the captain of the ship, I feel like people will not enjoy.
I don't think that's Jerry's argument. I think Jerry's argument is, I've been pretty much voted out of Survivor and I'm still here at the end.
I think Jerry would sell himself quite well. Like, he's very strong when he talks, and I feel like he would be quite powerful to listen to if you were on the jury.
And people have respect for, like, how he's done in challenges and how he's always, like, hanging with the young kids to do this well. And I think there is that general respect level as well, whereas Matt has burned some bridges. They both flipped on the heroes, but I feel like Matt probably felt like that was more on Matt, whereas they'd, like, voted Jerry out at that point.
With Jerry, he can literally say to the heroes, I came on, I did your bidding, blah, 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 after you even got rid of me. And I'm like, that argument wins for me.
I still feel like I would go Matt. I don't know.
You're flipping back and forth.
I think that it's quite even. That's why it's such a good solution for the both of them. Like, that's why they're here with George and they're just, like, riding those coattails to a degree.
Yeah.
So sorry for saying it, Jerry, please don't come for me. But if they can go there with him, if they could, like, really gang up on Liz next time, and I don't know that that's what George will want to do, because I think he wants to slice and dice, maybe have Liz and one of Matt and Jerry to be kind of between even one and one, the same way he was between the two and two. I think that if he could do that, that would be good for George. But if they can keep with George to a three, Matt wins a challenge, takes out George, one of the two of them has to win, and we're saying it could be a fairly equal shot. So that's a good solution for either of them, I think.
Maybe I have not been watching Matt's game as closely because I'm just like...
I mean, I think I also appreciate his challenge business as well. Like, that's something that's personal to me and something that I can appreciate. And yeah, he's been really strong in the challenges.
And the jurors will care. Would Sean care? Would Sam care? Would Flick care? Simon about challenges? I think yes. We also have to think about what people have said. You know, Shawnee saying things like, we'll go with Jerry to the end when she said that to Liz. So that might be how people are perceiving it. We might just take people of a certain age less seriously. Not that we should.
Yeah,
it's an implicit
bias,
but it might make it more difficult. And I know people
that's good heartstring to pull on, though.
But people have spoken about it. Like, sometimes it's hard in both ways because I think people who are older have spoken about... We've obviously seen, like, Shane Gould as a winner, but spoken about, well, I'm out. I've been out of it, and that's like a... Like, that's something that's been against me from the beginning, but then overcoming that is impressive.
Yeah.
So he definitely has, because there was that stage early on in the game. He had the sore ankle. It was just everybody wanted to vote out the weakest link. Mm-hmm. But Jerry is not weak. Like, we've seen him almost... That last challenge...
We hear Sam literally say, we're going to send you over because we can afford to lose you. Like, what?
Yeah. It would be a good way to come around that Sam would vote for him in the end.
Yeah,
that would be good. So for Liz... This is the issue I've had with her in the past. How good is that, by the way?
But also, I saw that scene and I was like...
Is that knife rusty? Because it's kind of like dark in colour. So
it's, it's really gross. Yeah.
No one cares about that.
Damn. Like tetanus?
Like, oh my God. That is a terrifying... Like, anyway, iconic shot.
It.
But for Liz, so my issue with what she had been doing was feeding into George's agency, lifting up his game, even though we did think she was important to him, and we do think she is individually important to him, and she continues to be. Mm-mm. She doesn't get what she wants here. She loses her agency because George decides not to, because he's so powerful.
I feel like you're giving Jerry way too much time and effort. Like, just get rid of Matt. Just keep it simple.
I suppose we can just
do it. You need to be, like, more... Just pull the trigger. He's playing to your emotions and it's working, because the way you're talking to me now, you would have never spoken to me like this a week ago.
That's true.
He's making you soft and you need to step out of it.
This has been my concern. You know, like, even though he'll always keep her around and he wants to rely on her, she wanted to use Nina. So I think that shows some of the flaws in what we've seen through her really working with his game. I mean, everyone's just really distracted by this image.
Yeah, sorry. She better cut her tongue.
But also, that flip on Nina was a last minute thing. Like, he did turn
to her. He had the control.
Yeah, but that was probably because if he said anyone else's name, she probably said yes as well.
You know, for Nina, I feel like there's like a good reason to take her out for everyone. And Brooke, I think you were in a similar spot in All Stars. Mm-hmm. That underdog narrative and those friends on the jury, he's saying if she has Simon, Sean, Flick and Sam, that's four of what, eight or nine jury votes, depending on a final two or three. That's very many. You know, then you're really having to nail every other vote, clearly.
Mm-mm. Yeah, I agree. I think that's something that people on the jury definitely look at, and I would for sure. Like, I love seeing an underdog. I love seeing them work from the bottom. And the fact that she's managed to be here after all the shots people have taken at her and literally just crawling her way through, I feel like she would get my vote.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, we lost some icons this week, and I think this is a good time for Khanh crosses out your face.
Yay! Do we have a jingle?
Crosses out your face. Crosses out your face. Welcome back to Khanh. Crosses out your face.
Hey!
Okay, on Nina. I don't want to cross Nina's face out.
Well, do it. last week.
Do you know what? Just to hurt you a little bit more, there's Hayley again.
Wow.
Nina is gone. I really feel for Nina. I really think that she struggled a lot this season. And Simon, oh, little puppy.
Oh, well, let's talk about these two icons, because I feel like they both contributed in their own way and are so important to the season. I mean, to start with Simon, I think it'll go down in the history books. His journey through the season with George, with the cookie idol, with the roller coaster that he had, I think it's all time. I think it's globally significant.
I was going to say he had his ups and downs, but was it just a down?
A lot of downs. It was an up, I think.
But I think it's changed my perception of Simon, which
clearly
means it's a great season for him. Because he came in and I was like, are you kind of a wanker? But then at the end, I'm like, I'm in love with you. You're the best thing ever. Like, you're the nicest thing. You just want to be loved. You're trying your hardest.
He really tried his hardest.
I want to say about Simon, something I was thinking as he was on his way out the door was that, no, but like, what happened to Simon?
So
no, like, I was literally thinking that it was a hard road, and the whole vibe of the season has been light and fun and really funny, and a lot of that has been with Simon and at Simon's expense. And I think with someone else, it could have gotten so bad that it was actually quite dark and weighed the season down. Mm. And it's such a testament to Simon, I think, as a person and as a Survivor character, that he lent into it and he was having fun and he's like, it's probably another decoy plan, and he's yelling in confessional and he's exuberant and he's having fun with it all the time. And if it was someone else, and I wouldn't have even have blamed that person for sinking into it, I think it could have dragged down the whole season. But instead, he becomes an absolute highlight of the season. Yeah. And I think that's such a testament to him as a human being, really.
When it feels like the whole world is against you, sometimes you have to find the strength to turn up for yourself.
And I think it's also the fact that he's, like, such a challenge beast that that he can do that.
He did win a car.
Mm. I did. Yes. Yeah, that is an up.
Yeah, there was that's one up. True. See, and he's out the door smiling and being happy, and I think that was just so important.
He was just happy to be there.
Yeah, and I think...
just happy to be included.
No, I think with Simon, he was just happy to prove that he can play and that he's strong and that he's capable. And because of winning all these challenges, I think he felt that...
He'd hit those targets.
I mean, and then what about Nina? Obviously, someone that you played with. Like, how did you think about her second season?
Oh, I think this was a hard season for Nina. Mm-hmm. I felt like in the season that she played with myself, she was very much in control and she knew all the plans, everything that was happening. And then watching her from merge of this season, she had no control. Like, she was completely fighting from the bottom, but I think she did a really good job. I think she fought really hard, and I think she should be really proud, because I'm pretty proud to watching her.
Mm. Wait, none of us have a winner's pick left. You both said Nina. Oh, I said Shani. Oh,
and I felt really good about Nina for a long time. Mm. I mean, I like that she got in there socially. She won a challenge. She found an idol. Like, she also ticked things off the bucket list. And I think she's such an important part for how the season has had reverence for the original heroes versus villains, and it's recognized that. And there have been these, like, accidental allusions to the season multiple times. And to have a Twine there sneaking around and causing chaos, and, like, it felt right.
And I think also she would be really happy coming back as someone who was injured, who got medevaced out.
Not getting injured again,
yeah, but also making it so far and making it further than she did the first time. I think, like, this is a redemption for her, and I think she's going to be pretty happy with it.
I think she held herself very well throughout the whole thing, no matter, like, considering what she had thrown at her. She really stayed true to her.
And if she ever played again, I would not want to play next to her. Because I think, she's hard.
I feel like she's got to win a season soon.
Yeah.
It's coming and I don't want to be there. I'll be watching.
Okay, it's time for a break. Stay with us, though. We have a very special guest coming in to talk all things jury. Welcome back to Australian Survivor Talking Tribal, and welcome to our special guest, two-time player Nick Iadanza. Nick, have you been enjoying Heroes versus Villains? Why or why not, but probably say why.
I am loving it, and thank you for having me. It's so good to be on the couch, and I just love this season. Not that our seasons weren't great, but I think that this season stands on its own as like a arc that you can just watch from beginning to end. There are so many threads that you can pull on. There's the Simon Cookie Idol thread. There's the George and Shiz thread. And these are just storylines that are traversing the whole season. Mm. And I think it's going to really stand up good on a rewatch.
Yes, I definitely agree. And what a great week to have someone who literally was my mentor in the week of mentors. Like, am I a pawn, do you think? Or do you see me as more of a student?
Well, I feel like now in the process, I've become the pawn. And you are definitely the mentor. You're sitting in that chair.
We rotate the chair, so it's
I'm very
really
happy to be a pawn to your mentor.
I'm just really happy that, like, you're here, because it feels like Mardi Gras World Pride again, where it started as a threesome and people kept arriving.
I don't know where you were going to. And it was to a destination I never could have ever possibly anticipated.
Well, I did already say, I was like, I feel like we make a really nice couple.
And I'll just sit here on my couch alone.
No, this is great. This is great. It's not just the torches that are flaming on Talking Survivor. Yeah, I feel like I'm doing pretty good here.
Is it getting hot in here?
It's been a big episode. Okay. Everyone, let's get back on track. Let's talk, because we wanted... So we've got two mayors of Jury Villa here.
Yes.
And I think that is essential as we look at... what a great group. What a great group it is. I think that we need to talk about it looking towards it being a final tribal council next time, and that being the whole point of the game. Nick, as the first ever mayor of Jury Villa for Australian Survivor, do you feel like you had an impact on that Jury Villa? And then do we think that, like, Flick, Sam, and then Shawnee, who've been there the longest, do we feel like that could kind of have an impact on this jury?
Well, you'd have to ask Brooke.
I'm just sitting here like, yeah.
Well, Brooke was there, and it was funny. So, you know, being the mayor of Jury Villa, you are the first one. And then every couple of days, a new person arrives with their version of events. Mm-hmm. And it's so funny, and I'm sure you can speak to this as well, that you see the story evolve every 2 days. It's like, that's not what Chinese the last person said. And it's like, no. And you feel like you've got the whole picture. Yeah. Even though you haven't been in the game. Did you experience that?
Yeah, 100%. And I feel as though we're told not to take things personally, right? So if the first person who's in the jury takes it personally, I feel like everyone else does. But if you're the first person and you look at things from an objective point of view, everyone else kind of does as well. So you do have that role where you can kind of shape and morph how people vote, but not actually influence them, but go, hey, you should actually think about games rather than think about, like, your emotions.
I agree. I think it's about... As the mayor, you know, these are roles that are important, you know? Come on, guys.
On your resume?
Yeah. Well, you look so fly on the jury. Like, we weren't allowed to dress up. We were told that we had to wear just, like, we had to look like we had just gotten off the island, but, like, still that we'd maybe been stranded
no
for a
makeup.
While. And then fast forward to Khanh's season, he's, like, sashaying down the runway.
Yeah.
It's like, you look at us, we look like we've just, like, Gilligan's Island.
Just shambled on the jury. Khanh's in, like,
yeah, actual Gilligan's Island. But no, it definitely is. You have to almost plant your flag of what you're going to stand for on that jury. And what I think that a good mayor of Jury Villa will stand for is gameplay and picking someone who is a good representative of the season as a whole.
Yeah, agreed.
The gameplay in your Jury Villa was legitimate because it was across, like, the aisle, and there were still these pairs in it that were doing it. For Nick, for you, I mean, Christy wins over Lee, and you're the mayor of Jury Villa, and mateship loses, and you hated mateship. Like, I don't think it's a coincidence. You have this, like, epic jury speech.
Coming together many years later. I think that is part of it. Not that we were actively campaigning for one or the other, but Brooke, you were there. We wanted you were there. We wanted someone who was going to represent at the show.
The first season,
who's going to set us up for success. And that's not someone who plays mateship. And I think that we've seen that evolve over the over the course of the series, that people take this decision really seriously. And it is. You are basically part of the crowning jewel of what we've all been
worked here for.
We've all been committing and all trying to make this thing happen, and we get to decide it. It's an important role and it has to be taken seriously.
I mean, another important thing for us was jury management as well. So I think that played a big role, and that's like something we've talked about before, is like George doing those winks and things to the jury and how he felt about that.
I think we actually have a clip of the wink. Do we have the wink?
You're kidding.
I've got mixed thoughts
a little bit. If you were in on the jury right now and you saw that, how would you feel?
Okay, so I kind of liken jury management to, say you're interested in dating someone, you know, or you're out on the town and say you want someone to show an interest in you, but if they start pursuing you too much, it's a little bit of an ick. Like, it becomes feels a little bit desperate.
I would love to be pursued.
I want to be loved. You'd like someone like this too?
Can you imagine?
It just feels like a little bit desperate.
False.
You know, and then that rings as hollow to me. It's like, I want the moves to stand for themselves. I've got two eyes, I can see. These are all really clever players who can see what's happening. We don't need you to kind of spell it out for us.
I agree.
It almost seems a little bit condescending, like, that one was for you guys. I think that one of the major components is not only thinking about, I'm talking more from the perspective of the players, is to think about how each juror fit into the overarching narrative of the season. You've just been voted out. you're sitting there wishing that you were part of it still and you were the one who was getting your chance to pitch. You want to feel like your time in the game isn't over yet. Mm. And I think the best final Tribal Council performances are the people who can engage you in the narrative still and make it feel like your time on that island was pivotal,
really important.
Was important. Yeah. And it, sometimes it's completely false and you have to just kind of like pitch things and hope that
something sticks.
Yeah. But I do think it's important in not only crowning someone that feels part of the narrative, but that everyone feels part of the narrative. Mm. Like it is a collective endeavour in the end.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, to put that on the other side of that, how if you're a player, like, so how do you do that? You know, so like in terms of, obviously, in talking about it at a final tribal council, but are there just other ways that you can really engage with that jury?
I think that you need to honour each player's perception of the way they played the game.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, right? Like, I think it's important. I think this is why, in going back to season one, why Lee didn't understand what we each individually wanted on that jury. We wanted him to say, look, I think that the way I tried to play didn't work and the way that you played maybe worked better and this bit was, I could have taken a little bit from Brooke and maybe a little bit from Sam Webb and drawn us into this story so that we then felt, do you know what, like, you have developed, you have grown, you have included me in the story. Because, look, survival players are narcissists.
Yeah.
Narcissists, selfish people who want to feel... Yeah, exactly. So I don't know. I think that's how you need to do it.
I agree with that.
Yeah, I definitely... I mean, the amount of discussions as a Survivor fandom that we've had for over 20 years on the jury, because it's so beautifully complex. Like, I've spoken to literally psychologists about the Survivor jury, because it is. It's about trying to cater to that specific psychology of how someone sees themselves, how they see themselves as still relevant, because everyone's the hero of their own story.
Exactly.
And you get voted out and you still want to be the hero of that story. And for maybe one of these people, that is true. Yeah. But it's how can that be relevant to me? I think that is a really good point.
You mean that we weren't individually the heroes?
To me, you were. To me, of course.
Khanh's
a villain. So, again, the jurors that I have, the multiple jurors that you guys have been, I'd love to know, like, swap it around from the players to the jury. What makes a great jury speech or what part of the new format? How can you be, I'm not trying to say a good juror because I think, like, that's, like, a subjective term, an entertaining juror to me. That's what I want, to know.
Just get Nick Guy dancing.
Yeah, well, Nick really went for it. I love it.
I feel like the jury format that I played in was very different. So I feel like I was the original format where one player gets to stand up and kind of
give
grandstand a little
speech.
Bit. Yeah, give the Sue Hawk classic speech where you can grill. You were part of the, you know, more communal. But, Brooke, you've actually been in both of them. Mm-hmm. So maybe you could speak to the difference between the two and if you feel that there is a way that you can get a better answer from one or the other.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like the All Stars finale was good in that we all got to ask those questions that everyone had been kind of saying back and forth, but the things that you've been dying to get off your chest, and they definitely come out. And it's good to see what was important to every other juror because that's what they focus on. I mean, for me, I think I went too hard, maybe in my jury. I know.
The limit does not
I was
exist.
Literally inspired by how savage Nick was in his in the first season. I just want to know if you think that was a smart strategy, considering you lied to a lot of us here on the jury, and we're all going to determine your fate. And it's really good to get their responses because, I mean, half the time you think they're just telling you what you want to hear. Mm. But that's what it's about at that time. Like, I want to hear what I'm putting out there. Like, give it to me. Flower me.
Yeah.
Cover me in compliments. Like, right now is the time to schmooze me. And that's what worked for me.
But don't you find that sometimes there's two ways to look at it? Like, some jurors ask the question wanting an answer. But some jurors ask the question knowing that answer will sway other people. Mm,
yeah.
It's like...
The game never ends.
Yeah, the game doesn't end. And it's like, look, let's say that I want Shannon to win. I might ask something that's really positive for you to win, like something where you can answer to be like, hey, the jury doesn't understand where your point of view is here, but I know that they would want to know that, so I would ask you, but I would do it in a favourable way to you so that when you answer, it would... sway some people.
There's also clever ways to word things. So you're trying to make a statement, but you're putting it in a question.
Yes.
Like you're trying to say you did nothing this entire season.
Yeah. How do you feel about the fact that you did nothing this entire season?
But you're trying to word it in a way that you're getting that point to the jury, like you said.
I think someone else literally just went, Whoa. Chrissy, you're a goat. Like, I literally used to remember that instead of Abby and Chrissy, and I was like, oh my God, you can't just call her a goat.
If I'm cringing at making a difficult tribal council speech, then that's pretty rough.
It's hard.
I do remember when we were, before final tribal council, kind of just, you know, maybe running our questions past each other, and I remember sitting Brooke down and saying, okay, this is what I'm thinking of saying, and then you were just like, I didn't know we could do that. And I was like, what, too much?
Oh, my God.
Am I coming in too hot? I'm like, you think?
While we were chatting, you would often tell me about your desire to play a moral game and to play with honour and integrity. Yeah. And I feel like you did snooker yourself. Because, Lee, time and time again, you would retreat to this place, this almost magical land where nobody voted for each other, and the people who came here to really play this game are forever shamed. That place is the moral high ground. And that is where you spent 55 days of the game, in my opinion. It was a place where you would hear this morality siren go off in your head like a tsunami warning, and you would retreat to higher ground. This pompous place of valor and honor and integrity, where Lieutenant Lee of the Morality Police would stand there and make judgment on other people for how they wanted to play the game. I just don't know, in the spirit of the way that you played the game, if I can award the money to a hypocrite who doesn't uphold their moral values.
Yeah, but I mean, based on the fact, as we're saying, that like everyone's a hero of their own story, and there have been jury speeches that will live in maybe infamy, but that are iconic. And I know, Nick, I mean, being such a fan, was that something that was important to you? Do you want to come out and be, like, an effective, memorable juror? Is that, like, something that a lot of these big characters will probably be thinking of?
I think so. Like, I wanted that moment because it's fun.
Yeah.
Like, well, not for Lee, but it was fun, right? It was fun, but it was also, like, when I watch a Survivor finale, I feel like the final tribal council is like the pinnacle. Yep. It's the climax of the season. Mm-hmm. There's got to be something in there for the audience to chew on. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they can't all just be questions that are, you know, softball questions or serious questions about, like, I need to know this one specific piece of information. I do think that you should almost know that information beforehand.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, like, final tribal council almost is like a little bit of a chance to get the players off kilter for one last chance. Mm. Like, you've spent 55 days, 40 days, whatever, however long the season is, how much can you stand in the last sprint? You're almost at that finish line. Mm. Can I kind of trip you up? Can I kind of push you in a way that will give you something really human and reveal something that I didn't know before? It's not doesn't come from a callous way. It comes from a, well, hopefully a good
Some
TV
people
way.
It probably does.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hopefully a good TV way, but also in a way that honours the severity of what we're actually doing, which is saying this person stands head and shoulders above everyone else and has for the entire season.
Mm, and deserves $500,000.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's a lot of money.
You've got to earn it. You've got to be tap dancing all the way to the end.
Dance, monkey, dance.
For sure. I mean, if you're going to be the winner of this season, Heroes versus Villains, that has been so epic, you got to earn it. So I think that the jurors are going to take that very, very seriously. Mm. Well, Nick, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank
we
you.
Need to take a break. Stay with us as we chat to Simon. Welcome back. Getting to a final two is a tricky pathway. Let's talk about it in World of Survivor. Yeah, so for World of Survivor, I wanted to talk about a final two. From the player's perspective, we're not really hearing if they think it's necessarily a final three or a final two. We're leaning a little bit to a final two. And last night when I couldn't sleep, I was thinking about all the final twos in Global Survivor history. And I was thinking about the pathways of how someone gets there, because it's really, really, really tricky to get down to it. It's not something we have in US Survivor anymore. They have final threes and Fire making it the final four. So I was thinking about it and I thought that, you know, yes, I was. That every time you've made it.
That's what you think about.
I couldn't sleep, so I was thinking about the final twos of all the seasons.
Some people count sheep, and I was counting these final twos.
I love it.
And I thought that there were basically three pathways of the winners who've won in final twos. Yeah. One, you win the challenge. Four of the six final twos we've had in Australian Survivor, they won the challenge. If they hadn't, they probably don't win.
Mm-hmm.
Then the other one is you're not the biggest threat of the final three. So, of course, the biggest threat gets taken out third. You go, and you're the second biggest threat. You beat one person next to you. That's pretty much it. Now, George is probably not going to win a challenge, and he is the biggest threat. That was my issue. So then there's a tiny other pathway that sometimes works out, which is human error or human emotion. It's loyalty. It's a friend taking you through when they shouldn't. It's Shan making a mistake to take Shane over Brian Lake, who she would have beaten despite winning the challenge. It's Wu saying morality, honor, misreading the jury. So it's that human error. And I think that if George has any way, it'll be an ally, a Matt or a Jerry. Yeah, if Jerry could win a challenge to take him, then Jerry has held his own to take him through. And I think for George, he has had that loyalty and allies before, like Kara, like Jerry. It is unfortunate that those allies are also not, like, particular challenge beasts. But do we see a pathway here if it's, like, for a final two?
I don't.
With George?
Yeah, I don't. I really don't see it happening.
I mean, unless it is the trivia.
Look, the challenge might work for him. But has George won a challenge?
No.
What about the KFC?
Oh, the KFC with Hayley. I mean, like, he hasn't won an immunity challenge. I think... Yeah, and I mean, he did very, very well in his final immunity challenge in Brain versus Brawn. It was hours and hours. Flick and Hayley were just crazy. Like, they were hours even more. So it is really tough. But, yeah, winning that challenge, it's really, really hard to not be able to rely on it. You look at someone like a David, who's that huge threat, and there might have been loyalty there, but he can rely on winning that challenge, and that's so vital.
Yeah.
Because usually the final challenge is an endurance-based challenge, right? We're not going to see a puzzle. We're not going to see something that's going to really work to benefit George.
Has that ever happened?
No, it's endurance.
It's always endurance.
For Australian Survivor, it's to the point where it's predictable that, like, Liz would definitely be counting on it being an endurance challenge that she could do really well. It's a part of the format at this point. So I think it is quite tough. I mean, I think George is in... It's funny, so many parts of it are similar to his last endgame, which was also tricky, but really different. The similar thing being, I'm someone who can't really win a challenge. But last time, he wasn't necessarily going to beat a lot of people at the end. So he had to get... He could be taken through, but he wanted to get there with someone he could beat, which was tough. Now it's like, it feels like he'd beat anyone, but then how do you get there? And so it is... There's those three pathways. They might be close.
I would be very shocked if it happened.
Okay, we have to move on. Now it's time for our chat with Simon.
Hello, Simon. How are you?
Hey, Khan. How are you, mate? I'm good. I'm exhausted. I'm exhausted, but I'm glad to be here.
Do you know, I've just noticed that you've got your hat on, and I actually have my hat. I have my hat here, so I think I'm going
to... Yeah!
Oh, my God, so cute. That's we're great. Matching.
Magic.
Okay, so let's get started. This year's theme was Heroes v Villains. Going into the game, did you feel like you were a villain?
I think I was a villain. Like, I always knew that, like, last time that I played that I had some unfinished business, but... Villains have more fun. And I knew that I probably played a little bit more as a hero last time and I probably needed to prove myself a little bit. So I took the liberty of being a little bit cheeky and just having some fun with it. Like, I'd never burn someone's hat. Like, I'd never do that. But you just have to get around it. You have to get involved. And it's a lot of fun.
Hey, on the burning of the hat thing, did he find out while he was there? Did George ever find out while you guys were there together?
I took that to the grave. So I did not tell a single soul. That stayed between Jonathan and myself. And so the first time that George saw that was when it went to air on TV. And it was pretty funny. So I did speak to him after that one, which was hilarious. To clear things up, I actually have sent him a hat, a snuff hat, to replace the one that he's got. So I won't be upset if he burns that one. I think that's fair.
I literally was thinking about burning this on camera right now, but I was like, oh, I don't know.
No, you wouldn't. Okay.
So as this season progressed, I fell more and more and more obsessed with you and in love with you. Now, do you think you played a different game last season to this season?
No, not really. Like, I came to get involved. I came to, you know, play this game. I was never going to be a passenger. And, you know, I wear my heart on my sleeve. I care about it. I love it. And so the motivations didn't change, but my approach kind of to it did a little bit. everything that I touched turned to ash. Everything crumbled around me. And it was really hard when you just need to keep turning up to yourself and trying to be resilient when nothing is going for you.
Okay, so you're talking about things crumbling around you. That means we have to speak about the cookie idol.
We have to speak about the cookie idol.
We have to. Did you ever question whether or not it was an idol?
Oh, yeah. Like, I was so skeptical as soon as I got my hands on it. I'm like, okay, there's no note, there's no necklace. And the kicker for me was probably the green emblem. I'm like, why is there an official green emblem on this? Like, this is obviously something. And yeah, the rest was history. But that cookie idol, how it defined my entire game, it was just like, that was the turning point for me, because it gave me the confidence to play with an idol and feel like I was protected at Tribal Council. It gave me the confidence to have a poke at the bear and, you know, have a crack at George, even at that episode 7 Tribal Council. And then it burnt me in so many ways, but it also, you know, it also got me through tribe swap. I mean, it got me a couple of friends temporarily, and then it all crumbled after you know, that ended up being fake and put me in the position that it did.
We see you and George butting heads a lot all the way before that tribal. I think afterwards you kind of simmer down a bit, but all before that tribal, it was intense. Like, what was the atmosphere like actually there? And are you guys still friends now?
George and I are still friends now. Like, you have to drop some things and you know, game respects game. But at that tribal, it was electric. Like, watching it go down in real time and watching my world spin around me as, you know, I find out that, you know, my best friend Geordie is now against me, and to, you know, have a really special moment where I won my first immunity necklace, just be completely overshadowed by this. I can't even like put into words, but this is the explosion of my game there. Wow, what a Tribal Council to be part of in terms of the history of the game. Like, that was wild.
Do you regret not playing the cookie idol for Stevie? I know that like it wouldn't have worked, but it's like it would have made your relationship maybe stronger.
No. It was definitely the right decision, because, you know, as my game crumbled around me, I needed one more day in the game like that. And that would just, I knew that, you know, I had immunity that night. That was great. Now I've got now like everything has fallen apart. It would have got me through one more, or I thought it would have got me through one more, but then, you know, it ended up being fake. But then the perception of having an idol might've just got me through. Right. So I don't regret that. And I actually think that I patched things up with Stevie pretty well.
Leading up to that elimination, when you walked into tribal, like, was that like, did you feel like you were going that day? Like, was there any inkling?
Oh yeah, that was like the way that George pulled everyone back together just blew my mind. There's only so much I can do. Like, my time is so well and truly over. And you know, I got through the last one. You know, the votes went on Nina. I almost made it through to the top five, and then the non-elim kicked me there. So it's like the first time that something goes right for me on this entire game that ends up being not a win. Like, I cannot win.
Mate, talking about games, I reckon you played an awesome game this season. You should be super proud. You won all of these challenges. You've won a car. So great game, great season.
Oh, thank you. And thank you everyone for the love on the snuff caps. Like, that means a lot to this little apprentice. That's been great. They look great on you. So
I'm gonna burn it.
Thank you. No!
Bye, bub.
Thank you, everyone. See ya. Bye.
Okay, that's all we have time for. We'll be back next week after episode 24 of Heroes vs. Villains. Listen to the Talking Tribal podcast for exclusive chat from tonight's episode, and check out all the Australian Survivor content on 10play. Before you go, enjoy a sneak peek of next week's Heroes vs. Villains.
I don't know what got into George's head. He did me dirty with Shawnee, and now again with Nina. He's forgotten our relationship. He's forgotten our alliance. I am furious.
The plan doesn't change this. You're just as likely as winning immunity as Matt is.
Well, that's what I'm hoping for.
And if Matt does win immunity, we bind together on Jerry. That's what happens.